Welcome to worship with Hayes First Presbyterian Church. Wherever you are and whenever you are welcome and you are loved. Today, in our gospel reading, we're going to hear about Jesus calling new disciples from really unlikely, out-of-the-way places, and how their willingness to follow changed everything, and how that call still is going out. And how we're being called to respond as well. You'll also hear about the upcoming election of new elders for this congregation and how everyone who is a member will be able to participate, either in person or remotely or by phone. We're gonna make this work for everyone. We'll also be sending out instructions because it may sound a little strange, but this is all going to work. That meeting will be at 11 o'clock on February 14th, and we will be in the sanctuary as well as Facebook Live and Zoom and phone. So pay attention to the instructions, because I'll be talking about it a little bit more, but also to the instructions that will be sent out in all the ways that we communicate here. My friends, there are lots of things in life that are kind of pulling at our time and our attention. And I would invite you in this time to just take a breath, center yourself, turn off perhaps all of your other distracting electronics, and do something that sets this time and space apart. Perhaps if you can do so safely, to light a candle as a way to remember God's light that illuminates your life, our life, and the world. My friends, let us worship God.
Christ is calling us as disciples.
Lord Jesus, let us follow you faithfully.
We will be led into the fields of mission and service.
Lord Jesus, where you lead us, we will go.
We will listen for Christ's call.
We are ready to serve the Lord.
Jesus called the fishermen, Peter, Andrew, James, and John. How could they just drop their nets? How could they leave their families and boats behind? Were they not afraid, Lord? What did the family and friends say? We have so many questions and maybe they did too. Help us to understand how they were able to say yes when you called them. May we be as brave as them when you call us to come and follow you. Amen.
Join me in the call to confession. Sometimes we must let go of our nets in order to follow Jesus. Let us confess our reluctance to follow and examine what we must let go of in order to follow Jesus.
God, you call us to come. We look around at all we have had to give up, and we confess that we aren't sure we want to let go of any more. And we admit that sometimes fishing for people doesn't sound great anyway. We've had more than enough of feeling trapped, honestly. So why would we want to do it to others? Yet you call us to bring in your people, to encircle them with grace and love. Even the ones who would rather swim away, we confess that it can be very hard to love our neighbor, and we are going to need more help. So we pray for your grace to abound, that we may live graciously. We pray for your love and justice to overflow, so that our only choice is to share it. We pray for courage to leave our old ways behind and embrace your way, wherever it leads. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hear the good news. In following the ways of Jesus, the kingdom of God will come near. Repent and believe so that you may live in God's courage, grace, and peace. Thanks be to God.
Mark chapter 1, verses 14 to 20. Jesus calls the first disciples. Reading from the New Revised Standard Version. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God, and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little further, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and went with Jesus. These are the words of the Lord.
You know, recently I began worshiping online with the Iona community in Scotland. I had so eagerly looked forward to worshiping with them in person immediately after Easter this year. The thing is, Iona and its faith community are a part of me, even if I never return in person, although I'm hoping to in 2022. The Iona community is now based out of Glasgow, Scotland, with a residential abbey on the tiny island of Iona. And the Iona community associates, which is what their congregation are called, live all over the world in intentional, extended, and unrelated, what they call family groups, who re-covenant every year to gather for worship and music and celebration and enacted faith in justice and peace. Communal morning prayer, that's a really important part of their covenant. And in this season of COVID, Iona has adapted the way that they live and worship in community with people who share a roof, recording pieces of each morning's virtual worship, very similar to what we do in this congregation. And in that morning prayer, they pray by name for associates and staff and ministries of justice and reconciliation, and they pray for the world. And so worshiping and singing with the Iona community, that has become balm for my weary spirit. This morning we prayed, "Holy God, we are your temple, not made with human hands. We are your body. If every wall should crumble and every church decay, we are your habitation. Take us outside, O Christ, outside holiness, to where nations clash at the crossroads of the world, and so shall your people be justified and find cause to bless your name." I deeply miss praying with others. So it's powerful and moving to pray and to hear voices from around the world, and to pray and sing with so many other faithful followers of Jesus who are committed to this way, as we are scattered and apart for the sake of safety, for the sake of that greatest commandment to love God in how we love and care for our neighbors. So every morning and now I look forward to that period where I can rest in the beauty of images of that far-flung, tiny, holy island. And each time I am in awe anew of God's expansive and life-giving vision. How could anything meaningful and lasting come from such a small and out-of-the-way place? Iona Abbey grew from a few small boats of Irish monks who crossed the Irish Channel fleeing Viking violence. And they came to the tiny island of Iona off the coast of Mull in the Hebrides. The whole area of the island is 3.3 miles. And yet since the year 563, the Iona community has nurtured and sent out communities of prayer and worship and action, and that has continued. That discipleship, that formation of discipleship, has continued to this day. And so in this week's gospel, as I was thinking about it in the context of tiny Iona, I noticed anew how Jesus' world-changing ministry was launched in the unimportant and out-of-the-way region of Galilee, on the shore of a lake that bears the same name. You know, I was thinking that in Jesus' time, that would be like starting up a nonprofit to eliminate systemic poverty and address structural racism on the shore of Lake Wilson without the assistance of the internet. I mean, who does something like that? And more to the point, why do Simon and Andrew, James and John, why do they drop their nets and follow him? After all, these men were realists. They were fishermen. They knew all about hard work and the struggle to make it in a Roman-ruled world that was not meant to work for them. So what was it in this good news of God that Jesus proclaimed that compelled them to drop their nets and follow? And so many after them, generation to generation, women and men, slave and free, Jew and Gentile, rich and poor, all languages, millions of people over thousands of years, joined together across all the boundaries and barriers that so often divide, as each heard, believed, and acted on God's good news. You know, I've been pondering the powerful and unlikely witness of the Iona community, with a reach and a mission that is so far greater than its source. Iona has an intentional focus on international and local cross-generational community. Associates gather as strangers and are formed for discipleship, and are sent out to be good news to the world. And while the island and the abbey hold precious memories, the international community has adapted to COVID safety while continuing to worship daily. And at the same time, they're actively building for the future. The Abbey is nearing the completion of extensive renovation. You know, after all, parts of that building are over 1,400 years old. And as I've been following the Abbey's renovations, one of the things that I noticed and that's really struck me was that the building is being restored with an emphasis on expanding formation and disciple-making of new associates, rather than for the comfort and the regathering of old ones. Like the first disciples who dropped their nets to follow, discipleship is meant to be good news in community, not a place or a building. And it's meant to be for the sake of the world. When Jesus calls the disciples in Mark, notice what's absent in that call. There's no rugged individualism. There's no you're on your own. No pulling yourself up by your own bootstraps. No follow me and then, you know, good luck with that. Rather, it's follow me and more followers will come. Follow me. You're going to be part of a community, something bigger, greater than yourself. And notice that Jesus calls them together, not separately. It's Andrew and Simon. It's James and John. Discipleship is not a self-sufficient occupation. God knows, Jesus knows, we cannot do discipleship on our own. We can't do life on our own. We can't live into our vocation, into our truth on our own. We can't follow Jesus on our own. I can't preach on my own. We need each other. In this time of virtual and remote worship, in a season of, let's admit it, heightened tensions and anxiety and conflict, that's tested what it means to be church in this time. And still, God's good news of healing and reconciliation and community and love, it's just as compelling, even more. It's just as compelling as that world-changing and life-changing message that Andrew and Simon, James and John, first heard and believed and followed. And I am grateful. I'm grateful to God for everybody who followed in their footsteps. Not knowing for sure where it was going to take them, but knowing that God is with them each step of the way. And that this church, in this small, unlikely, out-of-the-way place, well, we're part of that fellowship, part of that journey. And so on Sunday, February 14th at 11 a.m., we're going to hold a congregational meeting to elect elders to help us to discern what it means to follow faithfully in this time and place. And as in all things COVID, we're adapting. We're adapting our election process and practices in an effort to love and protect our neighbors and include every member who wants to be included. The session has approved the nominating committee's recommendation of a slate of elder candidates: Betsy Crawford, Stacy Kessinger, Vicki Johansson, and Tom Johansson. And I give thanks to God for each one of them who heard that voice of the church and who responded, "Here I am." And so, because it's so important that every member who wants to is able to participate, this meeting is going to be really different. We're going to do it in hybrid form. People will be invited, who wish to, will be invited to come in person to the sanctuary at 11 a.m., following all COVID mitigation practices, as well as on Facebook Live and on Zoom. And there will be a phone number for people to call in who use phones. And people who simply phone in will be able to participate as well. We're going to send out detailed information, because I know this probably sounds a little strange, but we've got a plan, and it will include everybody. So look out for how to participate and to vote. And then in a further, this isn't how we normally do it, but it works now. If the way be clear, which is Presbyterian, for if those people on the slate are duly elected, ordination and installation will follow immediately after the election. And if you were ordained as an elder or a deacon, any place, and you are hearing this, we would love for you to send us an outline of your hand in paper, and for you to please write your name boldly on that paper, because that will be part of a socially distanced laying on of hands. Your handprint on a piece of paper, send that into the office, drop it off, ask us to do a porch pickup before Sunday the 14th. My friends, the kingdom of God is at hand, right here and now. And Jesus is calling you to hear and believe and repent and live the good news. Thanks be to God. I invite you to please join me in prayer. Traveling God, your voice reaches us wherever we are, at work, at play, through screen and silence, in the endless ordinary days, even when we are numb to the possibility we might be called to belovedness and belonging. Your call is so urgent, so clear, to leave what we know, to discover that which seems impossible, justice, mercy, love, equality, that this is your dream for your kingdom here on earth, and we can be part of it as we follow you. And so we lift up to you, O God, people who live each day with violence and fear. We pray for our neighbors who are struggling, for our friends who do not see how they hurt or how they could help. We pray, O Christ, for all those suffering in body, mind, and spirit, for those waiting research, vaccine, or treatment that could bring relief, and for those waiting the day when every tear is wiped away, and for those who work each day to save lives and heal people. We remember, O Spirit, those who only know God through us and our actions as your disciples. Give us courage to speak up, to work, to care, to go out on behalf of those you love. We give you thanks for those who work to make our world, our nation, our state, our community, our church work for the sake of others. For those who step forward to serve in every office. From this church, we give thanks for Betsy, Stacy, Vicky, and Tom, who have heard your voice calling and have said, "Here I am." And Lord, we pray for those who hold leaders accountable to our highest ideals at every level. We pray for those who work behind the scenes and those who are on the forefront of the news. Give each one wisdom and courage to seek the good of all people and of your earth, and to do what is right. Holy God, help us to remember that we belong to you, and you are love, and we are beloved. Gather us up as your disciples, bind us together in peace, claim us so completely that we give all we have to be healers of the breach, offerers of grace, a voice of hope. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. Please join me in the prayer of dedication. Holy God, may the Spirit daily nudge us in the way we are meant to go. May we always look to Jesus as our guide as we walk this journey of life. Take all we offer today. Use our gifts of money for the building of your kingdom. Use our talents to help others come to know you and grow in discipleship. Lord, all we have we offer you today and always. Amen.
And so, my friends, called by God to follow, the time has come to go out into the world and to make God known to all whom we meet. And as you go, may God guide your path. May Jesus walk beside you. May the Holy Spirit inspire you today, tomorrow, and forevermore. Go in peace to love and serve. Amen.